grew up in Stevens Point in this, the program here, and I got my master's degree in Suzuki pedagogy here. But I think the most important element of why I'm here today is I am a parent of two. And I have a son who's 12 and a daughter who is 10. And I noticed when I would practice with my children that the time that we would play was when we would have the best time together, and actually would be the time that we would get the most accomplished, and the time that they would come back for more, or they would push the bar a little further. I'm hoping that today this will be a session that will spark some ideas. Games, they're limitless, and they will take you far, but I'm hoping that some of these games will lead you to new games that you can help create yourself with your children, because kids love games. And here's one of my home studio parents. When I moved to Madison, I wasn't a player for 13 years, and then I moved to Madison, and I noticed that her son Drake had this love of learning, and I started to dive in a little bit deeper, and I found out that they had a lot of games in their practice. And so I invited Amy to come with and bring some of the games that they use, and I brought some of the games that I use in practice with my own children, and I try to incorporate this into my home studio families. But I'll let Amy introduce herself and some of her background as well. But I'm hoping that this is a spark for you. And I'm thrifty. Actually, I've gone to the garage selling with Amy too. So I proved my thriftiness this way. But I like things to be inexpensive, accessible, and easy to do, because if it's inexpensive, accessible, and easy to do, you'll most likely try it. So, yeah, let's start.
Okay, I'm Amy. I have Drake. He was in the back of the room. He'll be back there later. But we put him in hockey, and he really wanted to play violin. So after like a year and a half, we put him in violin, and we were introduced to Suzuki. And once we figured this out, we started playing a lot of games, and we started practicing a lot more. And the reason I thought of the games is because before Drake was born, I went to school for education, and I worked in a Head Start program, so it's a federally funded preschool for underprivileged children. And a lot of times we had a hard time focusing the kids, but through song and play, we were able to really accomplish a lot in the classroom. And so I started trying to incorporate that technique into getting him to practice, and it worked really well.
How old is he?
He just turned 12. Over 4th of July.
So we have a lot of experience in different areas to help, and so I find sometimes, and I'm guilty too as a parent, we have that time constraint, and sometimes I find I've used the words, let's get our job done. Have you ever said that? Have you ever said, let's get to work? And so, you know, sometimes changing how we approach our practice can really make an impact. So let's just see, think about it, and say, let's get our violins on. Since my children play violin, let's play a game today, or let's see how far we can progress with this idea. If we approach it a little bit differently, you may see a little bit of a change in how your children may approach practice. And so sometimes using a game, you don't have to do it every time, but switching it up a little bit may save your practice. And I've seen how we kind of get into this place in our practice, my own practice with my children, where it gets a little hard, and you hit a rough patch. And so sometimes pulling out a game can save where you are and turn things around for you. And so we just have come up with some games that I'm hoping will initiate some ideas for you.
Sure, so I'll start with the first one on the list, which is the apple picker game, and that was Drake's favorite. So I used to make up little games while I was watching like a Lifetime movie or something at night when he went to bed. So I just simply colored a tree and then laminated it, and then I put little magnetic sticky magnet strips on here. It comes in a roll, and I just cut little pieces. And then I made little laminated apples, and on the back side of each apple is a color sticker. They come in sets of 1,000 for $1 at the dollar store. And I had like 4 purple, 2 orange, 1 yellow, like that. So all the apples go on a tree, and the child gets to pick an apple off. And if they have the orange apple, like I have here, then you reference the cue card, which is also laminated, and you can write on it with a Vis-a-Vis marker and just wipe it off every time when you're done using it. It doesn't smudge or anything. So orange would be humorous. So whatever your child's working on, you can just change the cue card every day, and it can include techniques like 3 perfect bull bunnies or a scale or something like that, or it can be part of the repertoire that they're working on, like play measures 14 to 23. With your metronome X amount of times. And then they just keep going until all the apples are off. And whatever technique you really want to enforce the most or piece you feel they need the most work on, that's the one that you would assign to the color sticker that you want the most of on the back of the apples. So 5 versus 1, you know, so you can sort of manipulate it a little bit. But it works well because I'm not telling him, down, you play humorous. He's picking it and getting to see for himself which one to play.
Great one. And you can even have your child draw a picture of the tree. So they're involved in that creation. And we were just talking about like switching it up a little bit.
So I thought, listening, I was like, we could make a squirrel, and the squirrel's trying to get all the nuts for the winter, and the back of the nut could be the stickers. And it, the cue card's the same. You just make the cue cards. It can be used for multiple different games. And yes, the kids can certainly.
Okay, I'm super duper excited about, I'm like not a hoarder, sorry, that's just not who I am. But I'm really excited about an egg shaker, I call it scrambled eggs. This has become the hottest game in my studio. Look at this, it's custom built for your practice delight. Super expensive, and yeah. So you take an egg shaker, an egg carton, and all you're going to do is write with a marker on the bottom the numbers 1 through 12. And I just randomized it because that's, again, who I am. I don't like writing anything or random. And then all I did was I took my student's assignment or my child's assignment, and I wrote on an index card their assignment. So this was a pre-twinkler's assignment that week, and I wrote, you need to do, number 1 was elevate. Number 2 is take a bow. Then it was your choice. So then you take an item, and I just happened to take a tiny little eraser, which is a chick, because I thought, aha, chick is scrambled eggs. It's kind of humor. And then you put it in. And then for those who are really excited and tactile, this is the best part of the game. And this is the best. And then you open it up, and wherever the egg lands, you're like, number 5. Okay, number 5. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? Your choice. And then the child gets to decide. What are they going to show you? And as a parent, so this is randomized, but then as a parent, we are still in control of how we are practicing here. But the still is just like so much fun. I've had students from pre-twinkle through book, I think, Drake, did you do this for me? No, not yet, but I have pre-twinkle.
For sure would, though.
You would do it, though, because pre-twinkle through book 5 have kind of practiced with this, and they loved it. Loved it. And parents have loved it as well, because they're still in control, and they can still write detail, like 3 bow folds. I had the student in book 5 have, please do 5 repetitions of the sights 5-3 with sparkly diamond double stops. So you can still be specific with your details in your practice. But there's that moment of, you know, and it happens, and it's so much fun. And you just, it's like a party, you know, in a box. Now, if you happen to have an egg carton, if you happen to have an egg carton that has holes in it, I just taped it. So, some do. I let you reduce, reuse, recycle, right? This is a big hit, though. They've loved it, every single one.
Oh, I'll talk about the bunny hop game next because it's very similar to the apple picker game. It has the same concept. So we were at Goodwill one day and Drake found this and wanted it for Easter, and it had all these little bunnies and chicks and stuff hanging on it. And I just put them on here so they would get tangled up coming to ASI. So on the bottom of each one, I put one of those little smiley stickers with all the different colors. And so I lined them up in the window ledge, and he would get to pick one and then do the assigned task. And then that animal got to go up on the Easter tree until all of the characters were gone. But it's the same cue card, and again, same concept. You get to pick what the tasks are or concepts for the day, and you can make as many different colored stickers as you want, depending on the age of the child.
My daughter, she likes to be, she's a little more laid back. My son likes to shake that shaker, like the eggs are gonna, he's gonna have to do the whole dozen. My daughter is a little more laid back. She's more tactile. She likes to color and cut the pieces apart and see what's on the coloring sheet. So I'll take a piece of coloring, this isn't even on the sheet, but she'll take a coloring sheet. I will look on it and back. I'll write down ideas of what she can do. She'll cut it apart and do that job, and she will put it back together like a puzzle. Another one that she loves is flower arranging. Now, I buy flowers at Michael on the off season, and I like to buy those stems that have like multiple flowers on it. So, for example, this was one stem, and I got this stem for like 15 cents or something. So it was, each flower was 5 cents. So for pennies, you can have a practice tool. So all I do is I take like masking tape or washi tape, and I put a little flag on it, and I put a number. And so the number can be, like if you look at the beginning of your Suzuki repertoire book, it can be like, it's that piece in there. So like, for example, if it's, you know, number 2, it can be lightly rows. If you just count the twinkles as 1. Or if it's number 3, it's Hunter's Chorus from book 2. Whatever. Or it can also correspond to a card. So if it's number 8, for say, for example, it can be a violin on shoulder for 10 seconds. Whatever you want to decide. And so then I take all of those flowers and I stick them in a, there we go, in my vase. And then she gets to decide how she's going to make her bouquet. Now, in this case, again, it's kind of like apple picker, where we have complete control. Sometimes I will put multiple 3s in this choice bouquet, or I'll put, you know, 4 4s or 5 6s or whatever she needs to be working on more. And so she may decide, oh, I really want, you know, more. Well, she loves roses. She'll be like, I really want to pick a rose, so she'll put a rose in her bouquet. And then she'll pick another, she wants this big yellow flower. So she'll practice this way, and it's been a really big hit. And I get them off season, so then all of a sudden I have poinsettias at the holiday time. It's been really, and it's super duper cheap. Really cheap. And then she likes to collect them all during the week, and she will see how many we can get all week long. They love it. And so then she's like, oh, look how beautiful your practice is. So for those of you that have children who are really a little more mellow in that way and are not going to be as want that tactile, like, you know, audible sounds, and this is a great way to have a quieter, visual, creative way to have a practice.
We have Suzuki cards, and I just colored a card for every song in book 1 when my son was in book 1. So this one is what?
That's the old Reid.
Yeah, so I made this one. But you can have the child make them too. Like Drake loved Run Pony from the variation. So he wanted to make the Run Pony. That was his favorite one. So he did it. And we just mix the cards up, and then he can pick a card and play that piece. You can shake a dice to see how many times to play the piece if there is more work on it. The other thing is there's other ways to do it. Like the kids could make a card as they're approaching each piece, going all the way through the book. And all I do is hard to get ready for their next piece. And so maybe they're excited about moving forward.
And if you have a child that's already advanced and you're like, oh man, I don't know if we can go back and draw all that many pictures, which I think is beautiful, by the way. I would love to have my child's art from when they were on that piece at that moment in time. I think that's fabulous. Meredith Strings has review cards. They have all of the repertoire, books 1 through 4, and then they have books 4, 5 through 8, violin, viola, cello. I think they may have bass coming out soon, but then you have all of the cards, and then they have cards by composers, and they're relatively inexpensive. They may have a few back down by the store even, but those are options for your years ago talent roadie. So you have the card already made. So this is a good option if you or your child are not as artistic as Amy and Drake.
With me,
and I'm so
cheap. Near strange. And there's like, it's one of the tips on the final page, their website, and everything is on there as well. Happy news are great. Oh, go ahead.
For those of us who are not decorated at all, a jewelry box is a good one. It could be a nice
yes.
pile.
Yes, including that right now.
And just, you know, having the, you know, working it out, letting the child know which what means,
yes.
and then having them choose the jewelry box is really trying to network.
Yes, it's fantastic. Yes, and having that. And I've also used the jewelry box to hold the card as well. So, you know, sometimes there's like a little place to put the rings. I've had the card sit in the jewelry box as well. Yes, absolutely. How many of you have,
yes? Oh, just for, Lucas likes to play with my phone, and we found this app called Decide Now that's like a spinner and it spins. And so he likes to spin it with his nose because then he doesn't take the violin down every time, and then he can decide what review piece. And you can customize, you can make a zillion different spinners.
Yes.
For people that like phone things, because I could.
What's
I also
called?
Love your craft. It's called Decide Now, the free spinner
free
app.
Spinner, or
there's several spinners.
Yeah, there's several
yeah.
spinners. Decide Now. I think there might be an exclamation point here. You'll find
yeah.
it over Decide Now.
It's so, we love it. And you can
yes.
make it, you could do a whole week's all the things in it, or just the songs from book one. And
yes, and then if you go like this, it just keeps on spinning.
And it, yeah, it makes noise.
During the holidays, we like to look, and like I told you, I'm thrifty. I like to look in the dollar section or look in the clearance section for whatever's in the holiday clearance aisle. And we like to hide the Easter eggs at Easter time or the holiday time. And so I take their assignment, I write it down, and I put it in the card. And we say, okay, in our house, we're going to hide your assignment in the kitchen, the dining room, and the living room. And then I set a timer on my phone. And then they have 30 seconds to find the Easter egg. Because my son, he likes to like stretch it out a little bit. So I say, 30 seconds, on your mark, get set, go. And he has 30 seconds to find an Easter egg. And so we have all of their assignments in the Easter egg. They find their egg, they run back, and they have to be back there by the timer goes off. Otherwise, I get to find the Easter egg. If they want to be in control of finding that egg. He's 12, he still wants to find that Easter egg. And so he finds the egg, and we pull up the assignment, and it says, place sites 2-3 with beautiful vibrato. So it's descriptive. It has the actual assignment that's being requested by the home teacher, because I'm not their home teacher. And so once they have that, then we close up the Easter egg, and we put it in the basket, because the basket is empty when we start, because they're all hidden, right? So big hit, super inexpensive. Even full price, they're only like a buck to get a dozen. So, but I still buy them at like 50% off, because that's cool.
Do either of you find that by constantly putting your violin down and doing something else, it's hard for them to pick their violin back up? That they lose the focus, and if so, how do you?
Sometimes that's helping develop the focus as well.
Okay.
So it's like, okay, I have my job, okay, let's bring it back, and then you've got the focus. So sometimes for my son actually, it helped develop his focus because he had that release, and then he can come back.
I can see that actually more than like, do you see?
Yeah, every game is different.
You know, so just know your kid.
Yes, know your kid, see what works, and you're gonna be like, you know what, the Easter egg game worked today, and you know what, the Easter egg game, or any game, overdone, over time, it starts to get old. And I find that after we do it for, like, the Easter egg game works for about a week, and they're like, okay, we play the Easter egg game, you know, whatever. And so we need to switch it up. And I'm not saying we play games every day at my house, because we certainly do not. It's probably maybe 2 times a week, because we are also, you know, we're getting our progress done here, which our practice is progress.
And for us, if my son, he started playing when he was 6 and a half, so that's the time we started playing the games, because he didn't play violin earlier than that. But the expectation was that we have the behavior expectations in the violin room, just like you have an expectation at school or anywhere else. And we can play and we can have fun as long as you're following the expectations. But if you need a couple warnings because you're not getting back to business and things like that, then you lose the chance to play the game. And, you know, just like with anything in life, you either have a reward or a consequence.
No.
They learn pretty quickly that they'd rather play the game, I feel like, because they're still gonna, he's still going to play it anyway. But he can have fun doing it, or he can, you know, just be told these things are doing now.
Yes. I have a question on your egg carton game. So the index card that you made up, do you send that home with them? I mean, if you prepare it, if you suggest it to a student, do you send that card home so that...
As a teacher, the first week I do. The first week I showed, the first week I was teaching them how to play the game, I made the card and I said, this is how we can play this game. Would you be willing to test it out? And so I said, we're going to make 1 through 12. Let's write your assignment down. Which numbers would you like your jobs to be? And then I sent it home, and then the next week when we came back and they asked how the game went, then I asked them, how would you make this yourself? So I'm empowering them to continue that forward, because if they can't do it themselves, then it doesn't allow them to have that freedom at home. So, because really it's, you know, just an index card with their assignment that they've been writing. When we have games that lose pieces or break, which happens sometimes, I keep all of it. Makes me sound like a weird word, but I'm not, I promise. I like taking any spinners, dice, and anything, and I save it because, like, this is an old, probably a collector's item. I wish I would have saved the rest, but that's the part that died. This is from a Thomas game, and it's just the spinner. So I've got Sir Topham Hatt holding the clock, and it's got 1 through 6, and so we have our job from our teacher. This is really not a game of any sort, but our Professor Pat said we have to play our review piece, and she says it has to be more than once. So we're going to spin the spinner. We're going to find out how many times, and it says we're going to play our piece 2 times today. So that's it. Mm-hmm. So it's not in my hands. It's in their hands. And they're not going to argue. They can't argue with me. They're going to have to argue with Sir Topham Hatt. So it's great, but any games that you have that lose pieces, watch children with games. It's usually going to end up in a brawl. But but the reason why is because there's so much passion involved. They're the rules, and they will help you create a new game if you've lost pieces in another. Take the chutes and ladders and write in skills that they already have and play the game as Suzuki and ladders. Play the game as, you know, book one and ladders or whatever you want to call it, and it's now your game. It's very easy to do. I know actually if you like Google Chutes and Ladders Suzuki style, there's actually pre-printed Suzuki, there's like pre-printed, you know, games already that all you have to do is print it off and it's right there if your child is at that level. It's really easy. But spinners like this, fabulous. My kid's favorite spinner on the planet is Life. The Game of Life, you can remember that too. Yes, you can all remember that with your mind. It's that ticker, you know, I'm telling you. They love it. Can we do it again? I can ask to do it again because they just want to spin that spinner again. Let's spin it again. So I'm like, well, you can't spin it again until you do what it says because that's what it's wrong. We can't argue with it. The spinner, spin it. You spun it. Don't ask me. Spinners, dice are the exact same thing. It's randomized. They have already rolled the dice. To roll the dice again, you have to do what it says. Even if it's like, here's 11. It's 11 mobiles. Even if you're a move 4, you can make a beautiful roll. mobile, we're still, both holds, well, they're timeless. We'll work on both holds until we're in book 45. So, you know, we're always in, the more we can hand our children their empowerment, the more they're willing to put forth that work. And that's important. Plus, we're teaching them that they can have control over what they're doing.
So, staying with the store-bought themes, as my son's getting older, we started with the Candyland and the Chutes and Ladders, like Janelle was just talking about, but he loves Battleship now. And so you can just take a regular Battleship game. And what I did is put into my computer every possible coordinate on the game board and assigned a piece or a technique to every single possible coordinate that he could select. And they started out with the Twinkles all the way through like book 8 and scales and arpeggios and etudes and things like that. But you can repeat and repeat the things that they need to continue to work on. And then I purposely put my ships on those coordinates. So he, in order to win the game, he has to call those pieces that I really need him to work on. And so basically, he calls a coordinate. You have to keep this sheet under lock and key because they will quickly memorize where the songs are that they don't want to play. But if he called, you know, D1, I'd say, okay, you have to play a martini gavotte, and then I'll tell you if it was a hit or a miss. And so then we go through the game like that. And I'll be honest, sometimes it takes a couple of days. We can play the game for a couple of days before he sings all of my ships. And the reason I don't laminate this one is because I randomly move the things around before we play it again the next time, because my child will remember where the certain coordinates were. And so then I switch it up so he doesn't know which sheet I have that day. And then, like I say, I still manipulate it because I'll purposely put my bows covering some of the pieces. I definitely want to make sure that he hits during those practices. So.
And this you could do, even though Drake is advanced, remember there's like over 40 things to do, 40 skills to do for Twinkle.
Or go from rest position to play position, you know, is could be one. Sing your next piece that you're going to learn. Like, you know, da-da-da, you know, so you can easily do that.
Or you can say, we're going to listen to a piece, a book ahead of where you are. We're going to, you can always, you can make it to be whatever you need or want it to be as a parent. Or your teacher is saying something like, you know, it would be really a great idea to try this or to try that. Whatever, you know, if you're a pianist, maybe you need to think about bubbly hands or soft hands. Whatever your teacher is recommending, put it in the match, because like she said, as long as you leave it open for manipulation, you can create anything that you need and create that as a game.
And then we always have like things like choose your own. And with him now, I put the ownership back on him for all these games. So the only way to progress forward is if you do it correctly. So you can't just play martini gavotte with your box back here, for instance, and your arm glued to your sides, your scroll is down. Then I say, do you think that you played this correctly? And if, oh yes, and then if he says, yeah, I'm like, so tell me, okay, let's go through each technique. How's your box? How's your bow hold? You know, and if he truly feels like it was right, I would say maybe I disagree on this point, but you're the judge of how well you did. Because I'm trying to get him to have that self-awareness versus me judging him, and him always looking at me in your lesson, like, did you do that right? Or looking to you.
With a smaller child, you need to have ways to measure, a younger child, excuse me, a less advanced child, ways to measure. Was your pinky on the back side of the stick at the time that you decided? Whatever ways to measure, concrete ways to measure success as they get more advanced, as in Drake's situation, having that, learning how to be more independent is important, right? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, absolutely. I like, with especially younger students or less advanced students, faster moving games. The clothespin game that I have down here is a great game. And it's a little bit related to Amy's dipstick game. Maybe she can come back to in just a second. But these clothespins are super fast, super easy. All you're going to have is like a bazillion clothespins right next to you. And every time you ask your child or your student to do something, you have to put a clothespin on their shirt or next on their slacks, and then you say, please put your feet in rest position. And they do it, you put a clothespin on. Let's go to play position, clothespin. Let's see if you can make a beautiful bowl with a round, pinky clothespin. And by the end of playing, they look like a porcupine, and they're just dripping, and they're actually dripping to do more for you. They're just like, and you're like, wow, you're like a hedgehog! And you're just like, I want more clothespins. What else can you do? Something else. So when they're playing there, clothespins are inexpensive. Most of us have them already right here for us. I mean, my daughter is 10 years old, but she did this about maybe 6 months ago. She was 10 years old, waiting for more clothespins. She'd play a whole science concerto waiting for a clothespin. And so, you know, when they're younger, we have a small job. When they're older and more advanced, we give them bigger, longer jobs to do. It's, of course, age appropriate, but it's that reward of, I've also taken clothespins and I've written on them pieces. So it's kind of like Amy has paint sticks, but you can write pieces on them. But I think that's too much work for me right now with clothespins. And then the clothespins are so small. So that's another option. I'm not sure what you do.
So I have the painter sticks. We had a regular wooden fence in our backyard that wasn't painted, and Drake loved to paint the fence, so I'd give him a bucket of water, and he'd go paint the fence with the water, and you could see it like, change color, so he would do that every day, paint the fence outside. So we made painter sticks, and so he could pick a stick, and then he could paint one of the fence, whatever those are,
slats.
Yeah, and so it has every kind of exercise all the way through the book. So like tonalization is one. And they can actually like color it on here. You could write it with a marker. They can put stickers on them. And then we have a painter's can and we stick them all inside of there. So some days I'll just pick out certain ones that I want him to do. Sometimes I mix up the books so he has some pieces from each one. But we don't have a yard with that fence anymore, so he can't go out and
make
the fence.
I love that idea. It's super great. And it's super flexible.
Very cheap. Ace Hardware gives them to me for hardly anything. I think they'll give me like 30 of them for like a dollar.
Now, I'm not saying all my practices are like dripping to do more, because they don't. We all know that. There are days when they're like, we're gonna practice. Go tomorrow. And they're cranky and we're cranky and it puts you in a place. You know the place. But we as a parent and as a teacher, it's our job to turn it around, not only for ourselves, but for our children. And so Amy came up with this great, these mood cards, and she had this clever thing that she did with Drake, and not that he was cranky, because Drake is a delightful student. But
he has his big moments, and he is delightful at Janelle's house, but not always he's delightful at my house.
Because we all have our moments, right?
So if he's playing something, I might like flip to this card and say, oh, you played it. Oh, I noticed you played Go Tell Aunt Rhody impatiently. Now, I give you a challenge of playing it mysteriously. So like, we'll stick there on that song because he didn't play it the way that I was looking for. So we'll go through some of these cards where I'll say, oh, I noticed that had sort of a grouchy bite to it. And what I mean by that is I could hear some crunching toward the bridge or things like that. Now, I'm gonna give you a really hard challenge. I am not even certain you'll be able to do that, but I would like you to play Go Tell Aunt Rhody in an interested way. What do you think that would mean? And so we let him play, and I'll say, okay, that was interested to you. It still seemed a little impatient to me. I wonder if you could try it once more. And then until we agree, and we'll just keep going through.
And that's a way for us, even as a parent, take some time, but still continue the flow of how lesson is going. So let's see, what about if it's interested, what is it interested about? What is it interested in? Ooh, is it interested in going to get chocolate milk at the store? Is it interested in how there's rings on the tree when a tree gets cut down? Is it interested in what happened at school today, because sometimes there may be something deeper that we're missing, and so we can get a little bit deeper there. But then, once we get that far, then we can turn it to the happy card or wherever we need to go to turn the practice around. And that's been really a great way to go. That's a great way to help turn ourselves around and our practice around as well.
Who knows who Terry Durbin is? Okay, my son loves Terry Durbin. He met him as an 8-year-old. So the silly card works for us almost always. I'll be like, you can't be grouchy, you got the silly card. So you have to play by telling everybody you like Terry Durbin when he's teaching his class. So he'll do something, he'll like squawk out and he'll love it. Or he loves to impersonate Terry Durbin. So that usually instantly is a mood changer for us. So if your child doesn't know who that is, maybe you can find a video on YouTube. He has a lot of silly videos on there. Or go find him.
He'll
do the talent show.
He's
going to do Old McDermott. So that's super funny.
Oh, super funny. Yes, if you have children here, I highly recommend going to see them tonight. Yes?
I'm
just
sad because I'm
rubbish. I'm excited. I hope you make it. If not, I hope we get to hear about how it went. I have to write 3M, the 3M Corporation, because we were going through a rough spot in practice. And all of this wasn't working. They would go with the Easter egg, and it was like, rah, Easter egg. And so post-it notes saved our practice. Sometimes it's the simplest things that can bring it back around, like a card or a post-it note. All I had to do, sometimes it's right there in your face, all I had to do was take a post-it note. Just like it was in the Easter egg, I just took it out of the Easter egg and I said, I'm going to hide these post-it notes and it's going to be in the kitchen. Exactly the same game as the Easter egg. I'm going to hide it in the kitchen, the dining room, or the living room. You have 30 seconds, go find it. And they had 30 seconds, bring it back. They would play their job, but this time they had a choice. You can keep your post-it note and collect it, or once you do your job, pick your favorite piece by Johann Sebastian Bach and play it, whatever the job was. And you can either keep your post-it note, you can get rid of it, or you can... You can have a party with it. It was fabulous, and it saved our practice. I think we all approached our practice at that time before that, like, okay, here comes practice. But when we started approaching practice as it's going to be simple, it's going to have a faster pace, here comes our 30-second timer, it's going to have our celebration at the end, or my daughter wanted to be just keep all of them and collect them. She wanted to see how many. My son wanted to make it like a ball or rip it up and throw it up in the air like it was a party. When we made it the simplest form of a game, it saved us. And we played that game, and like I mentioned, like sometimes we'll play twice a week. We played that game every single day for a month. Mm-hmm. Every single day. They asked for it. Asked for it. He was like, I think it was when my daughter was 8, my son was 10, so like 2 years ago. And that saved our practice. We were so focused, we were so directed. But sometimes, you know, getting into these little details of making things, I mean, these are simple, right? But making it just a post-it note can sometimes make it even simpler, even faster, not so much, and got us right to where we needed to be.
But you have to rewrite the post-it notes.
That's okay. I'll happily rewrite. But every week our job was different from our teacher as well. And I always would have two that said, your choice. I would have some that would say, hug mom. I would have one that would say, play in front of a mirror. I would have, you know, not all of them all at once, but I would have them every day. I would have one special one that would be, you know, something special for us, a moment in time in our lesson that was about an embrace or time looking at each other and be like, staring contest.
Here we go.
You know, who would blink? It was a moment of relaxation and time togetherness, and it made us feel good about being together again rather than practice.
So you did one note for each practice?
One note for every skill that we were supposed to cover. And then that your choice, and then that moment of fun. And it made practice for our family so much happier and full of joy, because that's why we're learning, right? For the nurture and love of our children, for their happiness. And so we want to keep that in mind, that we approach practice with love and joy, because that's how children learn and have that energy. Yes?
Okay, you mentioned your two children, and I am also working with two children. One of the challenges I face is coordinating practice. Now, they start at the same time, but my son is older, and so he's moved quite a bit further ahead. He's almost got twice as many songs in his repertoire. And so now I find the practice a real challenge. And can you offer any suggestions? How do you manage it? I am the Suzuki parent.
Right.
So the other parent does not do any of it.
Right. I my husband doesn't do any of it as well.
So they
are they as is your son considered your son as
my son's little.
Is he working independently at all?
Not really.
Well, they could do some together. When I would do the poster campaign,
right.
They would take turns. They would go back and forth. But at this point, I'm starting to manage up to 2 hours and 2 hours and 30 minutes of practice. My daughter is starting to finally do some independent practice.
Is that your daily?
That's daily.
2 hours and 30 minutes of training a day.
But we practice to get our jobs done, not to find a clock. We're not looking at the clock.
5 minutes a day with love.
You know,
when we start,
when I started transitioning him over to doing it, I still wanted to be like aware of what he was doing when I wasn't there. So I would give him a task, like I would make a little list where he could check the boxes off. And he had my husband's iPad. Now he has one, but I would have him record what he was doing. So he put the iPad on the stand, so I could see him and I could see his. You know, full and everything, and how he was doing it. And then I'd go through and like preview and be like, okay, I'm going to listen to this one. He would never know which one I was listening to. And if your child doesn't want to hear your feedback, that's a great thing, because you can text it back to them and say, oh, I would like to see you do this next time, so please pay special attention to that. And it is better received than coming directly from your mouth to them for some reason. And actually, I find you word things a little nicer when it's in writing than you might say, like, I told you 10 times to keep your pinky on the bow, or, you know, whatever.
For yours, not your personal children, but your students, do you have a kind of a ballpark practice times that you don't personally do that at different levels?
Yes, I usually recommend that they practice as long as their lesson is.
Okay.
It's a good general practice time every day. That way they're developing that focus for that amount of time. Now, I have students who have a lesson that's an hour, but they practice an hour and a half to 2 hours. But that's
different. But that's a minimal.
That's a minimal thing, yes.
Okay.
But then they should also be listening daily. But talk to your teacher about independent practice and how to start that. Every teacher's different. My daughter does some independent practice, my son does some independent practice, but for the most part, I try to allot for, you know, about 2 hours of time with them, and then, you know, I'm still managing my teaching time as well. Yes?
One of the things I did with my children when they were younger, when I had two of them, was I would turn around, and one of them would play, and I had to guess which one was playing. They liked that game. Yes.
That's a great thing.
I find I use it with a camera a lot. Both of the boys, when they look in the mirror, get all confused. But if I take pictures a lot, I can show them, oh, look at how nice your bow hold is here. What do you think about where your feet in this position? Sometimes they just take their feet, they're all, you know, whatever, which gives them, like you said, an opportunity to give feedback on how what they look like or whatever without.
They start to self-evaluate.
Right, and if you take a lot, do it a lot, I don't use them all the time. But they don't know when they're not distracted by me taking them.
Exactly. Yes?
I have a family that they have three children, and only one is taking lessons, and he's only 5 years old, and it's hard for him to come away from the playing time to practice, and the mother's asked for suggestions. In fact, they're going to probably get started on one of the lessons. So the two of them have to work with, like, But do you have any suggestions on how to coerce them away from the play to have them?
Say, let's play the violence as we practice, or making that board game, which is Ladders, or that Candyland, and having it be part of their meet them where they're at, rather than pulling them from where they're from, where they're currently playing. So make practice come to them rather than pulling them. So, make that game and say, we're going to make 10 vocals. Or, like, I play with these two cars, and I say, which one would you like to be? And then and I say, when you make a bow hold with a bent thumb, your car gets to go. And if your bow thumb is straight, then my car gets to go. And I make a big deal about it, or whatever that skill is. I use this a lot, actually, at institutes, too, and when I come practice. And this is a big hit. Actually, there's a lesson right before. And I know that, like, some of you need to pick up children. I'll be quick. So I said, bent thumb, you get to, was it bent? I asked them. And then we check. Oh, bent thumb, you get to go. I don't get to go. And then we move it forward. We have a finish line. They know it's coming. And then I had a little girl last week at Institute. She made it right to the finish line, and she did this. Well, you know what I have to do. It was the end of the hour. I said, okay. We did it again. Was it bent thumb? Yes. She got to move to the finish line. Guess what she did again? She was asking for more repetitions, correct repetitions, that she was evaluating herself. So you just went, oh, we're going to play the violin today. But this is, we're going to play. And this is how we're going to do it. So they're self-evaluating, but it's all about approaching playing in a whole new way. And they're going to go, this is playing the violin? Dr. Suzuki was surrounded by children because he made practice in playing the violin, all about playing with children rather than always about work. Remember those work and job, those words, like, ugh. We want to save work and jobs for adults. Play and have fun. Thank you so much for coming.